Morning, everybody. It's lovely to see people continuing to join, and we'll just wait a little bit until we have some more of our registered people in. My name is Sheila Deegan. I'm from the Creative Ireland programme, and we hope that you find today inspiring, enriching, and that you can bring what you hear today to build on your own expertise in your work as a public or a civil servant. Our event is called the Creative Bureaucrat, and we're talking about how creativity can drive not just the human or the physical aspect of a creative project, but also the human aspect and the way that we work. So some housekeeping before we start, which is that this is Zoom, and many of us will be familiar with it now over the past 18 months and know the rules and the best practice, which is that we will have people on mute while the speakers are talking. We have an opportunity for you to engage through the chat function or the question and answer function. And if we have time at the end, we will take questions, and you can do that by raising your hand and then you will appear on the screen. So without further ado, and because we pride ourselves on being on time, we are going to kick off. And I would like to hand over to Tanya Bonatti, who is the director of the Creative Ireland programme, who will introduce you to today's webinar. Tanya?
Thanks, Sheila. Welcome, everybody, to today's webinar. We're delighted so many of you could join us in what we think will be a really informative hour, and we see this really as a resource. We work across government departments, state agencies, local authorities, and creative partners. And although many of you, but maybe not all of you, will know that the underlying proposition of the Creative Ireland programme is that participating in cultural and creative activity promotes individual well-being, but by extension, it also promotes community and national well-being. So to deliver on that programme, the government committed to placing creativity at the centre of public policy. In fact, we're one of the first countries in the world to do so. So creative communities is a key pillar of Creative Ireland's work. And this is largely done in partnership with local authorities, all of you on this call today. The idea is to engage creativity as a strategy, really in three areas, as it contributes to well-being, as I've said, around economic development, and also around social cohesion. The interim review that we did of creative communities with chief executives of local authorities last year showed that our work over the last 5 years is clearly making a difference in enhancing the lives of local communities. And this has primarily been achieved through what are known as culture and creativity teams, a bit of a mouthful, in every local authority. The flexibility and the functionality of these teams was unique from the outset in drawing different services together, and it's proven a really adaptable resource to address locally relevant issues. We know that local authorities are lead agencies in the development, in local development, and they play a crucial leadership role across infrastructure, placemaking, enterprise, culture, community development, tourism, environment, all of these things, putting people at the heart of all of that. And I think that the creative communities model demonstrates that in many of the challenges that local authorities face as managers and as policymakers, actually using culture and creativity strategically can be very helpful in policy areas that people may not have thought possible. So today's presentation is going to be a wonderful showcase of the creative thinking by people in Meath, Sligo, and Cork City local authorities. I think there are learnings for all of us in how they've used culture and creativity to address regeneration and to reimagine places. And frankly, the range of different departments within each local authority that the projects touched on, planning, economic development, events, parks, roads, the elected members, senior management is really impressive. We know it's not always easy to collaborate, and we really want to celebrate your success. And I'm happy to say that funding from the Creative Ireland programme has been an important part of the process, as you'll see. And of course, we also warmly welcome our keynote speaker, Charles Landry, who coined the phrase, the creative bureaucracy, a concept that understands that people are at the heart of the system. They contribute at all levels to ensure that the places that we live and work are the places that we want to live in. So without further ado, if we could move the slide on, I would like to welcome Geraldette Bailey from Meath County Council to talk about the town of Kells.
Thank you, Tanya. And thanks to Tanya and Sheila and to the Creative Ireland team for inviting us to speak this morning. Many of you will have heard our fuller presentation earlier this year, so I'm just going to recap on some of the key points of the Kells Creative Placemaking Project, the bigger picture. This is a long-term, ambitious, collaborative project driven by a dedicated group of artists, community volunteers, and local businesses working in partnership with the local authority, which aims to stimulate growth through arts, heritage, and cultural-led regeneration. It's committed to the initiation, support, development, and delivery of quality creative experiences and activities in the town, and to the harnessing of the huge amount of energy, enthusiasm, professionalism, and commitment to Kells regeneration by the community in its broadest sense. It's also committed to the regeneration and adaptive reuse of key heritage buildings to develop an integrated network of arts initiatives, cultural facilities, and bespoke dedicated spaces for artists and the creative industry. As a project, this has evolved since 2009, and there have been long gestation periods for some of these projects. There have been many milestones along the way, many events, many funding strands and opportunities, a lot of which are listed in the next two slides. And just to highlight some of these, the establishment of the three festivals, Kells Type Trail, Hay, which evolved into the Hinterland Festival, and the Gutgaffa Film Festival, and the establishment of Kells Local Heroes played a major part in the physical regeneration of the town, and they were instrumental in the delivery of the five bigger picture conferences. The Heritage Council Kickstart Pilot, Solving Our Own Problems Weekend, and subsequent report, the Creative Ireland Culture and Creativity, and the County Arts Plan public consultation have all informed our actions. Other highlights in the programme are the discovery of a Victorian printing works, the Town and Village Renewal Funding, Fulch Ireland support of the Boyne Valley Tourism Centre at the Courthouse, the Irish Architecture Foundation Reimagine programme in Kells, the council purchase of the Sawmill Studio building for conversion into Kells Printworks, and the appointment of a design team for this. Success of the KCP RRDF application has enabled essential works at the courthouse and the opening of the cultural hub in June 2019. And you'll see from the next slide that in the first 6 months of opening, we hosted four festivals, 47 individual events, 9 school events, accommodated 51 artists, and had 3,000 attendees. We also secured Sealsha Films as our anchor tenants, and we provided Hinterland and Gutgaffa festivals with creative space occupancy. We have a large number of partners, and they are broken down into different groups. We have our core creative partners, our funding partners on the next slide, and our strategic partners. Some of these are local, national, and international. And we're very fortunate to have strong leadership and vision in the festival committees, local organizations, and people like community artists and activist Mark Smith. It's important to remember that as a bigger picture, that as with the key milestones above, Kells Creative Placemaking is no one event, organization, individual group, or even department within the local authority. Rather, it is the sum of all its parts. Each part has an important and distinct role to play, and each strand has its own unique timeline, funding, and its own story. Within the local authority itself, we have had the support of successive management teams. And a significant milestone for us was the approval by management to submit KCP under the RRDF scheme, which fortunately was successful. Our relationship with other departments and colleagues has evolved over time, each having different roles, And we work together in different ways, either through the delivery of our capital programme or in the initiation and support of projects on the ground. We have aligned actions under KCP with strategies and policies in local, regional and national development plans, some of which are on the next slide. This has assisted us with funding applications and with making the case both within and without the local authority for creative placemaking. It has also helped us to demonstrate where and how we fit socially, culturally and economically. Of course, none of this is possible without art, artists and cultural activity on the ground. And on that note, I'd like to just finish up with a short quotation by award-winning playwright Deirdre Kinahan from an introduction to a project we just finished filming at the courthouse last week, All Rise, the Courthouse Sessions under the LLPS scheme. I think she sums it up beautifully. It is in buildings like this that art is made. Buildings like Kells Courthouse can be found all over Ireland, and they speak to the history, culture, and community in which they stand. Art and story slip in through the windows, call out from the floorboards, and whisper through the walls. When you make a space like Kells Courthouse available to artists and local audience, you create magic. You facilitate local performance, travelling theatre, community workshops, music lessons, choir, creative writing, festival events, and most importantly, connection. All art comes from connection, the desire to understand, empathize, revel in, love or connect with the world around us, with humanity. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Gerdette. That's so rich in terms of the journey, the complexity, the multifacetedness of it, and I suppose the way that we all work at certain times. Love the idea of whispering through the walls. Thank you so much. So our next showcase, our next project is from Sligo. And I'd like to introduce Jolene Lynch, who is the Public Art Project Manager, who's going to talk to us about Riot. Jolene?
Thank you very much, Sheila, and thank you everyone for joining us this morning. And I'd especially like to thank Creative Ireland for inviting me to speak today on behalf of Sligo County Council. So I'm going to talk to you about Riot Sligo. Just move on to the next slide, please. So in March 2021, the culture and creativity team in Sligo County Council asked some difficult questions about how the values of culture, community and business can be mutually beneficial. Through a series of curated conversations, Riot Sligo brought together a whole cross-section of experts, innovators from places and projects that have been transformed. Sligo Town's potential and its future design was key to the reason for having these conversations and instigating them, as well as looking towards a future that can be shaped by creativity, imagination, innovations, our heritage, and essentially our ability to work together and collaborate. So in this presentation, I'm going to briefly touch upon the project itself, how it came to be, and where we are now in terms of legacy of the conference and also kind of the impact that it's had at local authority level. So if we just move on to the next slide, please. Thank you. So Riot Sligo 2021, in a nutshell, it was a two-day conference held virtually in March of this year, the 23rd and 24th of March, hosted by ourselves, Sligo Council's culture team, supported very kindly by Creative Ireland, who essentially made it happen. The conversations brought together a whole wealth of perspectives and expertise. These included academics, artists, activists, economists, members of the community, practitioners, civil servants, writers, planners, researchers, and that's just to name a few. They were very kind of enriching conversations, and the topics were based around creativity, culture, society, and our economy. We also had a sole conversation kind of talking about the meaning of culture, defining it, what it means for us and our communities, and how do we develop the resource that is culture to benefit our people, our community, and our economy. And last but not least, what is Sligo's position in the 21st century? So kind of reflecting on who we are now and where we want to be kind of in 5 years' time, in a decade's time, or even in 100 years' time. So quite a broad one there. And then the conversations, through the conversations, we discussed festivals, we discussed spaces, dereliction, community, tourism, identity, and as I said, they were rich and complex. So through kind of having the conversation, you know, it kind of unearthed a lot that potentially kind of one person speaking or lecturing wouldn't have given the same output. And you can revisit them all online. So the full recommendations are available at riotsligo.ie, or you can also go onto YouTube and they're freely available at riotsligo21, the handle there. So just moving on now to how the conference itself came to be. So after a public consultation of over 200 attendees, which was pre-pandemic, it is fair to say, we established the appetite across the arts community and local community within Sligo for this type of event. In combination internally in the council, we spoke to our Economic Development Directorate about how the culture and creativity team could collaborate on shared priorities as part of Sligo's culture and creativity strategy 2018 to 2022. So through that, there was the call for the conference, and it was agreed that the kind of aim of the conference would look for best practice nationally and internationally and how we could bring this forward given Sligo's commitment to cultural development, specifically in relation and in line with our cultural development plan. So that kind of sort of explains a little in terms of how it came to be, the key points there and where we are now. So the conference itself, both in the lead up and during, gathered a lot of councillor traction. So we had lots of buy-in from our elected member, our elected representatives, as well as the local arts community and kind of wider community itself, as well as our colleagues within Sligo County Council and other external and stakeholders. And the key aim of our cultural plan is to develop the urban space while protecting the very essence of what attracts people to live and work in Sligo and make their homes here and stay here. And working backwards from this vision, Riot Sligo helped to imagine the implementation of the Urban Regeneration and Development Fund, the URDF. So 48 million euros have been committed to this for Sligo. Part of this is the delivery of cultural services and innovation for Sligo in our new library, new museum, archive, creative innovation space, all of which will be adjacent to the pre-existing, the model, the Yates Society and Cultural Plaza, and integrating all of that together. So I guess to end, essentially the conference started conversations within the council across various departments that we hope and believe will continue to inform future strategies, in that it sort of instigated more cross-pollination and collaboration between departments, whether it be arts, planners, community workers, the heritage office within the local authority. And last but not least, in terms of legacy, we are still looking into the potential for a publication made up of all the content and themes from the contributors to the conference. So we really hope that will come into fruition. And I'm just going to leave you on a final quote that came out of Sligo, Riot Sligo, just for you to have a little think about. Thank you for your time. And if you have any questions or questions at the end, please feel free or contact me directly.
Thank you so much, Jolene. That's fantastic to hear how the future of Sligo is being shaped by a conversation that you started. Because often, the creativity agenda can be too narrowly conceived, but you allowed it to be open and collaborative and resourceful in terms of shaping the future. And collaboration, as Tanya said at the top, isn't always easy. So congratulations and well done. And the Riots LIGO website is a great resource, as Jolene said, for anybody that wants to check in and hear some of the conversations. So we're right on time, which is fantastic. And our next speaker is Michelle Carew, the Arts Officer in Cork City Council. And she's going to tell us about a project that was conceived during lockdown, delivered during lockdown, and has built momentum for Cork City Council going forward. Michelle?
Thanks very much, Sheila. Thanks for that introduction. And indeed, I'm delighted to be able to talk to you this morning and represent the Cork City Council Culture and Creativity team to talk about Ardu, a new street art initiative that was first delivered in Cork last autumn as a collaboration between the artist team, Cork City Council, and with support through the Creative Ireland programme. So our support of Ardu is underpinned by a broader development programme in the area of street arts, and it aims to create an integrated approach to placemaking, support the input of the arts sector and communities, and foster cross-sectoral collaboration within the local authority. So this project really was a prime example of the right idea at the right time. In summer of 2020, we were approached by the artist team behind Ardu with their ambitious proposal for a new street art festival that would platform great local and national street artists in large scale murals in the city centre. And this proposal landed into a very specific context. So we were at that point emerging from the first lockdown and strategically looking at ways that we could enliven the city centre and provide safe and impactful ways for the public to enjoy the arts again. And also it was a very important year in the commemorations calendar for Cork City. So we were marking 100 years since the burning of Cork City during the War of Independence. So the title of the proposal, Ardu, which means rising or rise, reflected that, and it resonated with the idea of the fact that the spirit of the city and the people of the city rose from the literal ashes of the burning of the city, and we would be able and up for the challenge of rising out of the challenge of the pandemic 100 years on. So into that very rich and opportune context came this proposal. And importantly, the proposal was coming to us from the right people. So the artists and organisers behind Ardu were synonymous with the development of street arts in the city. So they were the right people to partner with on such an initiative. So at the same time, next slide, please. Thank you. At the same time, the Creative Ireland programme had invited ambitious proposals from local authorities through the culture and creativity teams that would respond to the objectives that were within the July 2020 stimulus package. So our culture and creativity team saw the connection between the two, saw the opportunity. We identified match funding through our City Centre Fund, which is specifically around stimulating the city centre environment. And we put together a very strong proposal with Ardu at its centre. That proved to be the easy part. Very early on, we identified that in order for a project of this scale in the public realm on the timelines that we were looking at, in order for it to be delivered successfully, the role of the local authority in this case couldn't be limited to identifying the funding, providing some advice and support, and a general support in an arm's length way, which is sometimes the appropriate approach. But in this case, it needed a very much a partnership and a real sense of rolling our sleeves up and engaging hands on with our collaborators. And that's what we did. So the Arts Office, on behalf of the Culture and Creativity team, worked closely with the artists and led within our own team by our Community Arts Coordinator, Siobhan Clancy. We managed the procurement of services to support the project. But actually, the real value of our partnership and our role in this was due to our position within the local authority, our collaboration through the culture and creativity team and our access to all of the many sections that would be implicated in a project like this, from property to roads in terms of road closures and licenses, etc., heritage, conservation, planning, that was so important to bring all of the multidisciplinary approach of the City Council to bear on working on this project. So the process was a learning curve for us, as much as it was for the RDU team. And we built into the programme proposal a range of developmental elements that would capture, disseminate and provide a practical legacy from this project. So these included a street arts learning programme for practitioners, an intra-local authority knowledge share with our colleagues in Carlow County and Dublin City Council arts offices, where we shared knowledge and experience around creative placemaking and street arts. And very importantly, an inter-local authority series of workshops where we brought colleagues from across the council together to workshop on the notion of creative placemaking and street arts, and most importantly, really began a process by which we could find collaborative ways to efficiently manage the increase and the large quantity of queries and supports requests that we are getting in the area of street arts from businesses, communities and the arts sector. And that that work continues to this day. So RDU, in terms of the very visual public element of it, the mural painting kicked off in October of 2020. And the broader project continues to this day. So in terms of outcomes from the project where we are now, I suppose the most visible outcome would be the fact that the RDU Street Art Initiative has established itself really as a leading local and national, and I would go so far as to say at the moment international as well, festival for quality street art. Only last week, the second iteration of RDU finished, and four additional large scale impressive murals have been added to the urban environment. An early unexpected outcome, and there have been many from the project, I'll give you an example, was where our tourism section identified the opportunity, and with support from Fáilte Ireland, an audio trail and website was developed so that the public could self-direct and interact with the murals in a safe way, and that was a very strong legacy. There was a further packaging then of in-person tours with the artists themselves for the domestic tourism market for the Christmas period. And that was offered as an asset to the hospitality providers in the city. So a real economic leveraging there of the project. Our street arts learning programme across 3 months in early 2021 engaged 69 practitioners in all across the city. And we delivered that with the Irish Street Arts Circus and Spectacle Network, ISACS. We have developed a very practical toolkit, the Street Smart Toolkit, which is a downloadable resource from our website and provides all of the logistical and advisory information that anyone wishing to undertake an art project in the public realm in Cork City would need to know. A very solid output. I've referred to the internal collaboration and efficiency that we are driving towards as a result of this project. And fundamentally, due to the impact, the visibility of this project, the recognition of the potential of arts and culture as a key supporter of reaching the city's wider economic and social goals was really exemplified through its project. It has been really warmly accepted by and welcomed by the public. And I would go so far as to say, I think the project is a source of pride for the City Council itself, including our elected members. And it is a very strong cultural legacy from our COVID response. This project for me is an example of that creative community's goal of engendering creative strategic collaboration within local authorities. So thanks for listening, and thank you again to Creative Ireland for being a key supporter of this project. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Michelle, and you made it sound easy, and I know it's not, especially with the timelines, plus the different roles that you had to adopt. As you say, not just the kind of arm's length approach, but really investing personally and deliberately to bring all those partnerships to fruition. But it obviously it is a demonstration of how partnership, when it works, can work really for everybody's benefit. So next, we're really running on time, which is quite exceptional. And so next up is our guest speaker, Charles Landry. And as Tanya said earlier, he coined the phrase, the creative bureaucracy. So what's the creative bureaucracy? It highlights, he's going to go into a much more depth than I am, but it's about the human perspective of a bureaucratic system. And we, all of us here today, work in a bureaucracy. But what we're going to hear and be inspired from Charles is about putting our lived experience of working center stage, and how we're not just an organogram with functional relationships, that we are people, we have aspirations, we have ambitions. And as you can hear from the projects earlier, we live by delivering them. Charles, welcome. Welcome to Ireland virtually, and thank you for coming.
Well, I'm delighted to be here, as you can imagine. And can I say how much I admire what you're trying to do and what Ireland is daring to do, to put creativity at the centre of everything you do and to generate a culture of creativity that affects every aspect of life. And particularly, I like the idea that you're teaching silos how to dance, which is wonderful. So the creative bureaucracy, why, what and how? Obviously, these two words sound ridiculous. They seem to be in tension, but what it's about is recapturing the positive values that are part of a bureaucracy, which was once seen as benign and modern. And if clearly the word bureaucracy sounds a bit boring and creativity sounds exciting, but I love the tension between those two words. And essentially, it's an idea about empowering people. Now, when we look at the future, and we all know where we've just been in terms of the recent past that affects the future, we know that clearly the bureaucracy is not everything, but without one, nothing much can work. It affects everything that we do in one way or another. So to some extent, I think it is a wake-up call that we're all part of this, and the public administration and the civic and public good is incredibly important. So why now, at this moment, why has it suddenly become so relevant? I think we all know the world is changing dramatically, and we've seen it, we're living it, we're experiencing it. And one aspect, just a local art guy near me, he changes words every now and then, and he changed lockdown to luckdown. But actually, I think we need to see a sort of silver lining in that. And I think the three initiatives we've just seen exemplify that. I thought there were beautiful examples of that integrated cross-fertilizing and so on. And so I think one thing that happened in the pandemic, of course, is our hubris was sort of humbled. And we realized, for many of us, that this crisis was a time for deep rethinking. So the big issue, or one of the many big issues, is really how we deal with the fact that our civilization, as we recognize, is a thin film of order that we build around the chaos of events. And suddenly we realize the fragility of everything. Everything that seemed so solid melted away in one way or another. And so many places before the pandemic were already asking, how do we rethink how our places work? How do we blend nature into the cold urban fabric that sometimes is just sort of endless asphalt and so on? And what they've also recognized to some extent, and I think we all do, that we're 1 minute before midnight in many senses. You know, COP26 next week is a reminder of that, a stark reminder. And I think we all know that we're in the midst of a systemic crisis, and the business as usual approach will not necessarily get us to where we want to be. We're in a world and our way of life and our economic order is materially expansive, socially divisive, and environmentally hostile. And this is the cover of my latest book. And that line in the middle is the thing that I think we need to heal. So we're in a massive healing process. So we all need our plan Bs. And what is that going to be? I think this is a major event that happens every year in Amsterdam called We Make the City. And you can see some of the words in that, like let's make the city circular, let's make it more climate proof, more seriously smarter, more inclusive, and so on. So there's this incredible energy out there of both public administrators, the civic world and business world and academic world, who are wanting really desperately to move and to create what we might call Planet B, even though we need to make Planet A much, much better and immediately. So there is a kind of movement in the making. I mean, there are lots of initiatives from the OECD, other initiatives, which are all directing their way towards this notion that the public administration can rethink itself, do things better. But we within the creative bureaucracy movement are saying basically, yes, look at what those bureaucrats who already exist, can also offer to this dramatic change. So in summary, what I'm saying is a creative entity, whether it's a public administration or so on, harnesses the inventiveness in its organizations and creates the conditions for imaginative solutions to either opportunities, but also to problems. Now, we all know the critique, and nobody's pretending, and nor am I, that everything is wonderful in every public administration all over the place. Often it's a bit sort of red tape-ish. We know that, and we know you're all trying to get rid of that. We know often we're working in silos, and we all know that making great places is about collective endeavor, collective insights, collective intelligence. And we also know that often we write too many papers. These are some of the climate change issues from Paris lined up, and that we all want to actually do things and make the change. And so that's why we developed, based also on the little book, and I think you've got copies and you'll get them, I hope. In the worst case, I'll send you a PDF, is how do you create this new organization? And what it basically is about, and this is a simple central slogan, how do you move from a no because to a yes if culture? Now, that doesn't mean one changes everything all the time, but at least it means we stand back and ask ourselves, could we do this better? Might it work in a different way? So you allow yourself that reassessment, and being able to allow yourself to reassess things is really the thing that is at the heart of creativity. And clearly I think, and we think, that practically everybody can be creative, could be more creative than they already are. So the three aims of the whole idea is revaluing what the organization could be, revaluing and sort of seeing it more as a vocation, as a good vocation, shifting the image of what a public administration is and attracting new young talent, young people to join it. The three pillars, if I can call it that, is thinking about incentives and regulations for now, for the 21st century, 2021, now. Reshaping the inner life of public administration so people can give of their best and be more of themselves. And thirdly, connecting better with the outside world, civic, business, and education, and so on. And obviously the three aims and the three goals in that sense is to make the world a better place, more livable, all of that stuff, and to address the issues that really matter. Now, the central dilemma we faced, or that's what we thought about when we thought about the idea, was this notion of the decline of the common good. Now, thank God, with the pandemic, people have suddenly realized the common good is really an important thing and the public administration has a part. The rise of wicked problems, i.e. you've got to address a problem, but you don't really know the answer, and you know that the answer is likely to be within our collective intelligence. And also the recognition that the market on its own cannot solve these problems. You need to bend the market to bigger public purposes. And that, of course, as I said a minute ago, the solution is mostly a collective endeavor. Now, as I think you know better than me, many good people with positive values, great intentions, they're competent, they've made choices to work in the public domain. Yet somehow, and this is the negative side of public administrations in some places, hopefully not yours, is that somehow the structures do something and the good ideas and intentions and energies, they fade away for many, many reasons. And you've lived that experience, obviously. And that leads to frustration in various ways. But there is this talent. If you speak German, you know that Müll means garbage, but they've put on the garbage can multi-talent, which means that even us garbage workers, have solutions to problems. So what the main desire of the creative bureaucracy is both to build a better bureaucracy, but also in a sense to create another sort of culture within the bureaucracy. And you could call that new culture actually then ultimately a new organizational type. So what that then also means is also rethinking. We think the only creative people, and obviously the leadership needs to enable and legitimize this. And that's why your whole Creative Ireland idea is so fantastic, is you need that legitimation perhaps from above. But we often think that everything stops in the frozen middle, that level 3, 4, you know, that's implementing, turning actions into reality. But I think, and when you look at it, and there's lots of research, funnily enough, by Harvard, a school of governance, that actually that frozen middle is often the innovative middle indeed. And that's why we're also in our bureaucracy festival celebrating these unsung heroes. And many of you are in the room, whose names we never know, and we should know them more. So what that means also is recognizing that sometimes the public administration recruits bright people, but trains them to conform. But in their private life, they live this other world, this evolving world that's more socially media driven, agile in all sorts of ways. And we know there are negative things about the social media too. And we have to then recognize that we're in this breakthrough world, and that breakthrough, of course, is the digitizing world that is all over us. And sometimes we need to be aware that our information is not shared by everyone in the world, but nevertheless, it's all embracing. And we need to find rules and ways of operating that work both with, but also protect ourselves from the negative sides of a digitizing world. But this digitizing world, of course, makes many things easier and far easier than they were before. So in terms of thinking about what shifts a system, crisis can be useful, perhaps, and sometimes in the pandemic, the impossible became possible. A concept becomes important, like your Creative Ireland is in a way a concept, but resilience is a concept. Gender equality, sustainability, obviously, all of these things can change the way we think. But then, as you know, the EU is often now driven by this idea of missions. And I think within what you're doing in Creative Ireland, you have a mission. That mission is, as I see it, to put creativity at the heart of everything you do. You could call that a mission. But sometimes there's also a mood for change. And clearly in Ireland, there was a mood for change. Otherwise, you wouldn't have had this project in the first place. But ultimately, it's also about intentions and ethics and, in a sense, what morality we want to have and what sort of world do we want to create. So often, for me at least, you could say that what we're doing here is reframing, that the vision shapes the rules, not the rules' vision. So often in the past, a group of people have a vision and someone says, well, what's the rules? Okay, no, let's put it the other way. Let the vision shape the rules. And if we think about it, you're in a dynamic situation. And often there are rules and laws and regulations. And often they were written a time ago, but they didn't today. They might not sound right, but the spirit of that regulation or law actually reflects what you might want to do now. So sometimes one has to go with the spirit of what that law intended rather than the letter of that law. And I've asked myself for years, is it a different culture or a different structure we need? And I've concluded, I suppose, that what we're talking about is a different culture. And that different culture will reshift how we do things, reshift the regulations, make them more enabling, make them more empowering. So the future bureaucrat, their characteristics, their mindset, they know when to be open and divergent, but when to be focused. They know that they need to be looking at the future and have foresight, to have emotional intelligence, to have both technical skills, which we admire, nobody's not admiring those, but also these generic skills about communication and collaboration and so on. And that, of course, is the key working process. So what that means, perhaps, is we're moving from a known and predict and provide model to what you might call elastic planning, where you're strategically principled. You know exactly what your core aims are, but you have to be tactically flexible in how you go about it because you don't know exactly the future. Now, all of this might require courage, but it probably doesn't in your case. So what are you bringing? You're already bringing a lot. And so there's not much more that we can say. We in our work celebrate heroes and heroines of the movement, give them awards. And we're also obviously looking at the future. And this is the daughter of Annalisa Boni, the lady who runs, the Cities Net, Eurocities Network. So that's all from me. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Charles. That was so inspiring and so wonderful to hear how people at the center of something can make things happen. But I love that idea of being strategically principled, tactically flexible. Often, especially when you're working with legislation, it's hard to think that you can be tactically flexible. But I think the projects we heard about this morning demonstrate that. We have some time for some questions and they can go into the chat and we'll try and they can either be directly to Charles or to any of the speakers or just a conversation. There's one from Sean, which says, fascinating insights, those specific ways for those organising such as mine, the Fiddle Fest and Fairies. Okay, I know that's in Donegal. And of course, the Donegal tradition of fiddling is an excellent example of how local is important at every point. I think Sligo said it there, Jolene said it, how do you protect what's unique to Sligo, but at the same time being strategic. If anybody would like to respond to Sean or to that idea of holding the local, I know, Geraldette, you said 2009 you started your project. 2009 seems like such a long time ago and all the things that have happened in between, and keeping it and holding it, but in partnership, bringing on board, bringing the outside in, ensuring that the engagement piece was part of the process. I know that at the very outset, you worked with Irish Architecture Foundation and a bit like Riot Sligo, asked the question, how can culture help transform? Would you like to, or would Jolene like to speak to how asking the question provided some of the kind of simple standing back that Charles referenced there? Gerdet, are you on?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. What you referenced there, the Irish Architecture Foundation, the Reimagine programme, we had a number of public consultations through that programme, and also earlier than that, we had the bigger picture conferences, which were organised by Kells Local Heroes and ourselves. And that was a series of five conferences back in 2015 to 2017 that looked at the various ways that arts and culture could regenerate a town, how architecture could regenerate a town, the greening of Kells. It took different subjects for each conference. And then people were asked to give their feedback on that and to submit their ideas and see what they thought. And the Heritage Council solving our own problems that weekend was instrumental in us, being able to focus some of those ideas and thoughts, because it brought together people from every aspect, from commerce, from business, from hospitality, from tourism, from the arts and cultural sectors, over a weekend to the ballroom in the Headford Arms in Kells, where people sat and with facilitators looked at what were the problems, what did the people of Kells feel the problems or the issues were, and what were the solutions that they proposed. And then this came back to us in the Solving Our Own Problems report. And the Culture Ireland, Creative Ireland, sorry, the public consultation that we did for the creativity, for the strategy, that too informed an awful lot of the actions that we now have under the KCP. So I think keeping at the core of what we did was people, place and identity. What was Kells' unique selling point? Kells is associated with the Book of Kells, with learning, with, you know, with the arts, with culture. And it was keeping that at the core of everything and then seeing how that then could branch into all of those different areas through public consultation and the feedback that we received.
Thanks very much, Geraldette. And I know similarly in Sligo, and Jolene, you may not have been in Sligo in situ at the time, but I know that you had that pre-pandemic public consultation. And again, having the conversation, being open, being letting the vision shape the rules, as Charles said, was key to what you did in Riot.
Yes, absolutely. The approach to have the conversations was to enable kind of an explorative and kind of approach to ensure that everybody had input from all of the different mindsets and experiences, both in Sligo, in the town, in the county, as well as nationally and internationally, and really in a kind of weird set of circumstances. The fact that we were pushed to have it fully virtually was much more beneficial, I think, in terms of where we are in a society and just in terms of where we are globally and all the things that Charles mentioned in terms of climate and this shifting feel that we're all experiencing, and how creativity can, you know, has the power to bring us forward, but how we do that as a collective is the most difficult thing.
It is. And I mean, it's I suppose it's part of local governments, that consultation piece is a really key part of local government. So it is important to do, but it is difficult. There are a couple of questions, Charles, in the chat. One from
Yeah,
Victoria.
I've read them.
Okay.
I'll try and answer them. That was Victoria, Tara and Matthew, all great questions. I'll just try and summarise some of them. One of the questions related to, are there differences in different nations and localities about how they take up this idea or how creative they are? I think, and I'm generalising wildly, it's quite difficult in places like Spain and Italy to be as creative as one would wish, partly because the way recruitment works, they have these public recruitment things and it says we need 200 XYZ. And the way the systems often works is you have to be a lawyer to actually answer the questions when you're going through the recruitment process, or you might need to have studied economics. Whereas in fact, when you look at people who are really interesting in public administrations, they might come from a completely different field. And then when you contrast that with the Nordic countries, there's a much more, let's say, open approach that can also be quite bureaucratic, but nevertheless, they've seemed to have loosened up. And we gave a prize at this year's festival to the Finnish government and Demos Helsinki for instituting their humble governance approach. And what that involves is, for example, in education, that the teacher is teaching, learns from the students, finds out that their method perhaps doesn't work, incorporates that thinking, brings it back towards the larger educational authorities, and that in turn has an effect on the curriculum. So it becomes a sort of learning loop. So there's the whole idea. So look up this notion of humble government. There's another example I want to give you, which is a more local authority example, but it just exemplifies what we're talking about. Helsingborg, which is very interesting, look it up. It's doing a massive event in 2022, where they give an award for failure. So people who failed get 5,000 euros. And with those 5,000 euros, they are mentored and go through a process which is essentially trying to make their work better. And what is beautiful about both of those examples, the Finnish one and the other, is it's all about this learning loop, this continual loop. In relation to Matthew's question, talking about the new European Bauhaus, that addresses a bit this notion of the mission. And as you know, Ursula von der Leyen proposed that, you know, about the green transition, but also aesthetics and so on. And, you know, the Bauhaus changed 100 years ago, a bit how we built things. But now Bauhaus today is something completely different. And I think these sort of initiatives, a bit like the European Cultural Capital Initiatives, can drive ambition because you've got a process. And obviously it helps that there's a bit of money involved. Now, in relation to Tara's question, which is what happens when a genuinely creative agenda, brackets artistic agenda, conflicts with an economically driven agenda of government and bureaucracy? This, of course, is at the heart of what you're trying to do here. And to some extent, you're trying to overcome that by proving through evidence and other things and the examples we've seen today that actually these things are not necessarily in contradiction. So that's why this vast work of evidence building is so incredibly important to show the actual effect. Clearly what you're addressing is an issue, but this is the issue that Creative Ireland and all of us are on about, to try and prove that that is doesn't have to be in conflict.
Indeed, we're in the business of using taxpayers' money and using it effectively and using resources efficiently. So this collaboration idea, instead of trying to reinvent...
I'm confused because someone said, is my scarf the Coventry scarf? No, it's the Creative Bureaucrat scarf, a sash I was wearing. So that just answers that question. Sorry to interrupt.
No, not at all, not at all. I think collaboration, which we all recognise, isn't easy. And I think, when Richard Florida's book originally came out about the creative class, this notion that creative people were kind of sitting around holding hands and saying everything's going to be fine. No, there was a tension. And as you say, Charles, there's a tension in the two words, creative bureaucracy. The tension continues to exist, but it's that collective endeavor that gives us the energy to drive things forward. And you see the demonstration of what we've heard today is that oxygen of creativity that is helping to kind of change. I see Catherine Collins, who's one of our Creative Ireland coordinators, in the chat, is saying that how do you show that we are imaginative? Well, I think what you heard today, hopefully, Catherine, and I know the work you're doing in Waterford doesn't lack imagination. And it can sometimes feel frustrating, as we saw in Charles's presentation, to work across boundaries needs a certain type of leadership, a leadership that rarely gets credit. But that's what today is about, is giving agency to the work that is happening in that way, in a particular way, which is generating change, a paced and purposeful incremental approach to change. And as someone who's around a long time in the public service, it can be frustrating that things take time, but it's also extremely rewarding at the same time.
I think, interesting, can I just say something? I think this notion, when we talked about humble governance a minute ago, it's also part of a whole idea of humble leadership, which effectively what it does, it trades and exchanges power by giving away power for more creative influence. And that as a model is being seen as often much more productive in every sense.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I suppose for a long time, it was hard to put creativity on the agenda. And I think it's in your book that you say the danger of creativity agenda is narrowly conceived and sometimes can become hollowed out. So that's a nice idea of this trading and bartering of ideas and to give power to and credibility to the work. So we're all...
Sheila, there's one final question around the business sector that Colleen appears to have asked twice, just in terms whether any of our speakers have come across innovative approaches in the private sector. Charles, I just wonder, obviously you've looked a lot at local authorities, local and central government. Did you come across things that the private sector were doing that you could maybe give as examples to us here?
Right, and my brain's scrambling. I'm sure there are, because I'm looking at all these questions simultaneously and trying to think, as you know. I think what is happening is, I did a session yesterday with a foundation, and we were looking at startups and all of that and asking whether the business world is shifting more to this slightly broader view. And from within the startup world, it seems to be that more than before are really seeing this large, obviously we know about social responsibility and all of that, but actually seeing this bigger context that collaborating with the public sector achieves more within them. I'm sorry that that's not a specific examples lined up, but I was asking the guy who brings together businesses across Europe and investors about this question of whether there is greater notion of the common good in terms of the startup world. And that brings us back to sort of people like Fridays for Future. There are younger people who are saying, look, business as usual doesn't work. And also we as business need to rethink.
Thank you, Charles. And Colleen, hopefully that answers your question. But as Charles mentioned, he has sent on some of his writings, which we'll send out to you, and you'll be able to study them studiously and maintain some of what we heard here today, which is that policymakers can continue to have structured conversations around creativity, but to advocate from a no because to a yes if. Taking those two words, that creative bureaucracy, that seemingly are in tension, but are they just radical common sense? And how can they be used in an engaging and open-minded way as part of the solution and the behavior change that we need in terms of ensuring that creativity is embedded into public policy? Thank you, everybody. We hope you enjoyed today's webinar. And as you know, it will be available to view on our website and the Irish Architecture website. So some thanks to Geraldette, Jolene, Michelle, and Charles for your wonderful inputs today. Thank you so much. To the team at Connect the Dots, Naomi, Orla, and Sabrina, thank you so much for working with us. And to the Irish Architecture, who are our partner, and as you know, they are doing great work in reimagining place with a number of local authorities as is. So thank you, everybody, and hopefully we'll be able to meet in person someday soon.
Thanks a lot. Bye-bye, everybody.